item 6A, and this is the text amendment 2024-03 to the ULDC. We've got Mr. Dillard and Mr. Davenport for the presentation.
Yes, sir. Mr. Chairman, good morning. Good morning, Commissioners. Mr. Davenport and I are going to tag team this. This text amendment mainly focuses on two key areas, one being the number of lots accessible off a single point of ingress and egress for neighborhoods. Staff weighed in many options here, debated this for quite a while, provided you with several options. Mr. Davenport has an update on that. The second is a tree bank amendment to allow for commercial development, primarily to continue without having to go through a variance to our requirements for protected trees and tree replacement. So we've made some updates to that as a way to help expedite the process through a financial fee that some commercial developments can place instead of waiting the minimum 60 days to go before the Zoning Board of Appeals. There is still an option for the Zoning Board of Appeals, I understand, but it limits the amount of relief from the tree bank requirements. So you can't just cut down an entire forest and not replace it. So in an effort to keep Lowndes County green and beautiful, we've added this in here. With that being said, Mr. Davenport handed out a few of those updates that were made. I'll let him take it from here. Let's get back to the podium, sir.
Chair Benson, how are you, sir?
Good, sir. Thank you. Thank you, JD. Ultimately, the key staff in this is just ready to present the commission, especially with one or two of these updates that have taken a quite amount of work behind the scenes. That work stretched into this weekend, was Saturday, and even through yesterday, just to make sure we had something we felt like was ready for your consideration this morning. And so really, JD and Mike and Glenn Coyne worked on the tree bank amendments. They actually stretch beyond tree bank for that section for tree protection. So if you want to look at those, but ultimately we really had really four updates to present to you this morning since you received your packet last week. The first is the one revolving private water systems. We have learned about the standard that we want to set here in Lowndes County as far as those being on a backup generated power source. And so we have some language we prepared for your consideration with Steve's cooperation about making that a reality, at least for new subdivisions going forward. So it's a standard that I think we have learned the hard way that it's something we want to put down in Lowndes County, especially for private water systems. So that's what we've done, to try to put some language down to strengthen that for future ones.
And if I could interrupt, Jason, just for a minute there, Mr. Chairman, staff is looking for some direction from the commission regarding existing water, private water systems. If you are interested in looking at generator requirements for existing water systems, because I knew that was an issue during Helene, certainly, and whenever we're out of power for days at the time, if you all are interested in pursuing that, then we will move towards working with the county attorney to see what legally can be done regarding those types of requirements. But for now, what we have presented is on the new private water
system.
Yes, sir. But if you all are interested in backing up and looking at the existing ones, then we will get with the county attorney and see what our options are legally there.
Well, I'm going to ask, and of course, Ashton is here. Ashton, this is kind of in your wheelhouse. I know at some point, I think it was FEMA or GEMA was having some sort of grant program for certain facilities for generators. Would these private water systems qualify for that, such as a nursing home or such as that?
So, I believe so, but rather than yes, just so happen to have the assistant FEMA administrator who is over that program, it's going to be here Thursday, so that's one of the questions I'm going to ask him.
Good.
Clarify, and that's the hazard mitigation program, so that's still the best deal I've ever given. It is a 725. Okay, basically you generate the 25%.
And the reason I asked that question, I just think it would be a lot easier on for the commissioners to help them come to a conclusion about existing water systems if we can provide some sort of assistance to get them the generators that they need. Because it's important to the citizens, because one of the biggest complaints that we got out of Lane was the fact that these private water systems did not have any backup generators. So not only were the folks out of the electricity, they were out of order too.
That's right.
So that was important for me to think about that a little bit as time goes along. But I agree that right now the best way to address it is anything you go involved.
I'd like to know maybe what we can do with those existing systems. But we're talking about a
not require it to be permanently affixed. It requires there to be a permanent supply from a generator once the power goes out. So they could still, it could still be some sort of plug and play that they bring it out, but it's required to be there, so they can't hop it from system to system moving forward. But whether it's something that's permanently on the site or not, we didn't go that far with it. We just put language in that we feel very confident explains that it's got to be a permanent ongoing supply until the power is restored.
Any other questions?
But commissioners, on that one, if you see something that we can make it stronger, but otherwise this is where we got to go. We feel like to put a foot forward on this issue. Yes, sir. Moving on to the tree bank pieces, some clerical changes. We know they're minor, and that's fine, but we put them in there just so you know what we're doing. Really, the main change was trying to address what trees we're going to protect. Right now, we say existing trees that are over 8 inches of DBH. They have been enforcing kind of a no-pine tree, maybe all oak policy for some time now. This really clarifies what are you really going to talk about in this tree bank that actually needs protecting. So, ultimately, that's where we started. Georgia Forestry Commission has a document that's 98 pages, talks about trees in Georgia. We don't want to go that far. We whittled that down to about 9 trees and eventually got to about 6 that we thought were worth protecting. Pine trees are exempt. We have considered all pine trees, even large ones, as not a protected tree in this definition. So that just clarifies that particular issue to get ready for y'all's consideration this morning. And then finally, access, the main issue we've been working on for an extended amount of time. Ultimately, what we've done is we have a draft prepared that addresses some what we call policy goals. Those policy goals are listed in your packet. We call them goals because we're going to let this be worked out on a case-by-case basis for those existing subdivisions that trip these thresholds. And really, the streamlining there is about the fact that we analyze them on a staff level with the county manager. We don't go to the ZBOA. We don't have to come back to the commission for like a rezoning condition. When this hits the ground for those existing subdivisions that are expanded, for example, if one is outside of the service area for county water, we can say county water is not required. That's been one that's been a very consistent question. So I've got ones in mind right now, as do you, that like they are not within a reasonable distance of county water, so we're not going to require that for that particular subdivision. So with those conditions, we are calling them policy goals because we want to make it clear it's something we're going to analyze on the staff level. So that probably is the main question we've had is what about these conditions and policy goals? So the idea was not to require variance, not to require rezoning, to do something on a policy level that the county manager and really staff had control over. So that would be one point. The second point is there's been some talk about what number do we enforce 2 points at? And really we've gone anywhere from the state will say 30, Georgia will say 120. We've kind of settled on anywhere from about 60 to 80, most staff has. And ultimately, the amendments that you have in front of you show an 80 number. And so depending on what direction the commission wants to go, we have 120 prepared. We also have 80 prepared. One of the things that we learned in addition with Helene is these circumstances do happen. And while I have extreme confidence in Public Works and Fire Rescue and the Sheriff's Office to blow through any barrier that's blocking a citizen from any kind of care, it does cost time. And so as a part of that, that decision is probably the most important one that we'll put on the commission for tonight is what number do you want staff to use when we enforce 2 points? Right now we've given you multiple options, but it seems to be most of the consensus is at 80. But we're happy to address whichever direction you'd like us to go. We're really waiting to hear from your direction this morning.
Commissioner, can you comment on that? Personally, I think 80 is a good number. Still maintain a certain level of safety for our first responders getting in and out of some subdivisions. I think there's already some requirements from the standpoint of cul-de-sac and turnaround radiuses for our trucks and all that sort of stuff. So I think, personally, I think we'd be fine with 80, but now that's very good. Jason's just asking for your consideration on that number. And that's, again, just one point of interest.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
previous experience at having that entire document as our book